Okey, selamat pagi tuan-tuan dan puan-puan. Terima kasih kerana sudi hadir bersama-sama kita pada pagi ini untuk sama-sama saya memberi siaran media atas kejayaan yang dijalan satu kes bagi CCID Bukit Aman. Untuk makluman tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, pada dua hari yang lepas, iaitu pada 26 hari bulan September 2018, jam lebih kurang 1:30 petang, saya telah mengetuai satu pasukan penggeledah dan juga pemeriksa pegawai-pegawai yang terdiri daripada CCID Bukit Aman, dan kami telah menjalankan satu serbuan di satu premis di kawasan elit di KL Central, Kuala Lumpur. Pemeriksaan dijalan pada 1:30 tengah hari tadi, dan seperti mana saya sebut, kawasan ini adalah kawasan elit di mana terdapat beberapa pejabat-pejabat yang menjalankan tugas ataupun international trade di sana. So, dalam pemeriksaan kita pada hari dua hari lepas, kami telah berjaya menumpaskan satu sindiket call center ataupun pusat panggilan telefon international di bangunan tersebut. Di dalam bangunan tersebut, premis itu, kami telah berjaya menumpaskan call center tersebut yang terdiri daripada lebih daripada 99 orang semua sekali. Ini agak terbesar sekali di recent time bagi serbuan sebegini. Dan dalam serbuan tersebut, kami telah mendapati bahawa mereka yang terlibat pada masa serbuan sedang menjalankan penawaran atau membuat penawaran perkhidmatan pelaburan kepada pelanggan-pelanggan mereka di negara China. So, di dalam pemeriksaan tersebut, kami telah berjaya menangkap 99 orang yang terdiri daripada 93 warga negara China dan 6 warga negara Malaysia. Umur tangkapan yang kita telah buat ialah di antara 14 tahun hingga 44 tahun. A 14-year-old youth sehingga ke 44 tahun. Daripada tangkapan berikut, lelaki ada 78 lelaki kesemua sekali, dan wanita ialah 21 wanita. Kami percaya kami telah berjaya menumpas sindiket tersebut yang boleh berkeuntungan lebih beberapa juta setiap bulan. That is the minimum. They are making millions per month. Atas sebabnya ramainya call centernya yang membuat panggilan call center, dan juga mahalnya premis untuk disewa. So, jumlah rampasan kita ialah sebanyak 169 unit telefon bimbit dan juga 114 buah komputer riba ataupun laptop kita dan beberapa buku-buku catatan yang lain. Tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, mereka semua ditangkap di bawah Seksyen 420 Kanun Keseksaan dan juga di bawah Seksyen di bawah Akta Immigration tahun 1963. Untuk makluman tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, kita telah baru-baru ini mendapati ada influx ataupun kenaikan bagi call center ataupun pusat-pusat perhubungan panggilan telefon di Malaysia. Dalam beberapa minggu yang lepas ni, kami telah berjaya menumpaskan dua lagi call center di Johor Bahru. So, ini menunjukkan sindiket-sindiket sebegini sedang kiat tingkat beroperasi lah di sini. Untuk makluman tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, bagi tahun 2018 sahaja, kes-kes Macau scam di Malaysia sahaja, mangsa di Malaysia adalah mencatatkan lebih kurang 100 juta ringgit setahun. Easily about 100 million per year only for Macau scams only. But overall cybercrime cases, we have more than 500 million ringgit losses per year. And this is a very substantial amount. Dan kami dapati bahawa sindiket-sindiket ini sedang beroperasi di Malaysia. Untuk makluman tuan-tuan dan puan-puan, kenapakah mereka memilih negara Malaysia untuk menjadi pusat call center dia? Mereka menggunakan sistem komunikasi yang terada di Malaysia dan sebab murah juga kita mengadakan call center di Malaysia dan mangsa mereka adalah di luar negara. Call center sebegini ataupun Macau scam yang kita adakan ni boleh berjaya menjalankan operasinya atas dua sebab. Sebab yang pertama ialah wujudnya kebocoran data peribadi pengguna-pengguna kita. We understand that our personal data is stored by telcos, by various other institutions, dan jikalau data ini dikompromi, maka ia boleh dijual kepada tangan penama-penama yang menjalankan skam tersebut. Sebab yang kedua yang mereka berjaya menjalankan Macau scam dengan begitu berleluasa di Malaysia ialah sebabnya wujudnya sistem VOIP, iaitu digunakan untuk mengendalikan panggilan daripada luar negara ke negara ini. So what happens is, with the data that they have, the personal data of the individual that they have, call centers, kalau mangsanya di Malaysia, call centernya selalunya berada di luar negara Malaysia. Mereka menggunakan international call yang menggunapakai VOIP ataupun Voice Over Internet Protocol untuk menukar nombor international itu kepada satu nombor telefon yang lokal. So apabila penama di Malaysia menerima panggilan telefon, beliau akan menerima panggilan telefon yang tertera di atas telefonnya yang menunjukkan nombor telefon lokal ataupun nombor telefon yang mereka selalu suka buat ialah nombor telefon balai polis yang berkenaan. So this is the way the scammers work. Dia akan memakai VOIP untuk supaya menukarkan nombor telefon international kepada nombor telefon lokal dan lalu memperdayakan mangsa untuk memindahkan wang tersebut ke dalam akaun-akaun mule accounts dan seterusnya duit dikeluarkan dengan serta-merta. So we realize that such cases are on the increase. As I mentioned the last time, the normal cases of cheating, i.e. one-to-one cheating, is not on the increase, but cases of cyber crime cases are definitely on the increase, and jumlah mata wang yang terlibat akan meningkat setiap tahun. The numbers are actually very, very large now. So mereka menggunapakai cyber system ni untuk menipu mangsa. Baru sebentar tadi saya telah mengadakan satu mesyuarat dengan pihak Hong Kong dan juga di China. Mereka pun mengalami masalah yang sama, iaitu mereka mengalami jumlah kesnya meningkat 10 kali ganda di negara masing-masing tersebut tu, di Hong Kong dan di Singapura. So saya merayu kepada rakyat Malaysia supaya berwaspada apabila menerima sebarang panggilan telefon daripada berkemungkinan nombor itu menunjukkan nombor balai polis, berkemungkinan ia menunjukkan nombor bank atau seterusnya, jangan sekali-kali memberi maklumat perbankan kita. Jangan sekali-kali memindahkan wang kita kepada akaun orang lain. Jikalau ada sebarang masalah, beritahulah penama tersebut yang memanggil kita supaya datang ke balai dan membuat laporan polis. Sebabnya, pihak polis tidak terlibat langsung dalam usaha apabila memanggil penama datang ke, untuk memindahkan duitnya ke akaun yang lain. A lot of victims, which are victims in these cases, what happens to them is the person will induce them by using threat to get him to transfer his monies on the pretext of money laundering to an account which is a mule account holder. So saya merayu kepada orang awam, jangan terpedaya dalam kes-kes sebegini. Ramai menggunakan sistem VOIP untuk menukarkan nombor telefon dia jadi menjadi telefon balai polis yang berkenaan ataupun bank yang berkenaan dan seterusnya memperdayakan dengan cara menakutkan dia untuk memindahkan wang dia kepada akaun milik suspek. Jikalau ada sebarang masalah, hubungilah pihak polis dan akan tetapi jangan sekali-kali memindahkan wang anda kepada mana-mana akaun. So, bagi kes ini, kita telah berjaya menumpaskan sindiket yang beroperasi di China. Seperti mana saya sebut, mereka menggunakan call center itu di luar negara beliau dan akan menelpon mangsa-mangsa di China. Dalam kes ini, mangsa-mangsanya kesemuanya daripada negara People's Republic of China. So, mereka akan menelpon menggunakan VIP dan seterusnya menukarkan nombor dia jadi nombor badan penguatkuasanya untuk menakutkan mangsanya dan seterusnya memindahkan wang ke dalam akaun-akaun di negara China tersebut. So, kami telah berjaya menumpaskan sindiket ini yang beroperasi di China. Dan pihak polis ada lagi satu masalah iaitu dari segi masalah pertuduhan di mahkamah. The problem arises towards the charging in court because the offence occurs in China dan call center ada di Malaysia. Ada sebarang soalan tuan-tuan dan puan-puan? Hong Kong and Singapore. Yeah. Slip of the tongue, yeah. We are working together basically to solve cases of these cybercrime cases, especially Macau scams, African scams, which is on the rise in all three countries. For Hong Kong, they told us their Nigerian scams is tenfold increase. Incidentally, they had one case recently where they had about 95 million ringgit loss in an African scam. And the scammers were from Malaysia.
The meeting with Hong Kong and Singapore with your counterparts, so that didn't happen here? Or
Yes, that's what I'm precisely saying. The meeting that we had with the Hong Kong and Singapore police is, we are working together, where Hong Kong reported one case where a victim was cheated up to 95 million ringgit, and the perpetrators were in Malaysia. Nigerians in Malaysia. So the lady was scammed up to 95 million ringgit within a period of 2 years. And most of the accounts which we actually check at the end of the day are mule account holders. The minute the money is transferred to these accounts, immediately it's transferred out.
Were there any decisions made as to
what? Yes, we have. We are going to work together. Ada lain soalan mengenai kes ni? Yes, sir.
Sedikit dah berapa lama beroperasi di Malaysia?
Kami sebab ramai telah, kalau kita lihat pasport dia, telah ada di sini beberapa bulan yang lepas. So, kami percaya mungkin sindiket ini akan berpindah-pindah berkemungkinan dalam setahun yang lepas.
Dalam masa guna apa?
Pasport. Pasport pelancong. So, sindiket ini boleh menanggung penerbangan mereka ke Malaysia, tempat tinggal di Malaysia dan seterusnya membayar. Kalau boleh membuat semua itu, maksud di sini ialah jumlah keuntungannya mestilah tinggi.
Tak ada exact figure.
The total losses will be actually quite high, but the losses are in China.
Datuk Sri, apa peranan 6 orang rakyat Malaysia itu?
Ada di antara mereka Malaysian di sana sebagai security guards di sana, ada sebagai penterjemah dan ada juga sebagai mediator dalam jika mereka ada sebarang masalah, sama-sama pun terlibat. Kami telah menangkap seorang Datuk Seri yang sama-sama berada di premis tersebut.
Datuk Seri, what about this VOIP? Is there nothing the government can do to stop it?
The problem with this VOIP is the VIP can be dynamic. Dia boleh berubah-ubah. Itu adalah salah satu masalah yang kita we have at the present moment. We actually urging the government to get these telcos to upgrade their system to be able to tell us where the IP address is from using this, where the calls are coming from. Because other countries can do it, but Malaysia we find it difficult. So we are urging the telcos to invest more in their system to be able to assist us where such calls comes in, they can locate where the IP address is, where the call is actually coming from. Giving us a number which appears on the phone will be futile. As I mentioned to you, nombor yang tertera di telefon adalah nombor yang kita pakai. It could be a balai number dan sebagainya. But we are interested in the IP address, dari mana wujudnya panggilan tersebut. Where did the call originate from? We can pinpoint the location, we can pinpoint where it actually came from, and we can get the assistance of our counterparts in the countries. That is the reason why we're having such meetings with the Hong Kong and with Singapore.
Datuk Sri, apa peranan individu yang bergelar Datuk Sri dalam sindiket ini?
Kami sedang menyiasat.
Berapa usia dia, Datuk Sri?
40-an. Losses for?
With the syndicate, how much money do you suspect that they actually con? And is the con the same as in Malaysia, where they taking the police and investigating?
Okay. The modus operandi of this syndicate is the same as victims here in Malaysia. As I mentioned, the call centers are always situated out of the country. They use the international gateway using this VOIP, Voice Over Internet Protocol, to call victims in the victim's country. Once a call goes through, they can use a mechanism to change the number which appears on the phone. So the number will not show a foreign number, but will show a local number there. So these are for victims in Malaysia. You will see on the phone a local number of the Balai Polis, or you may see a local number of Bank Negara, or you may see a local number of one of the banks in Malaysia. And the caller with access to personal data, where leakage of personal data can frighten the individual into transferring the money to the suspect's account.
So for China, the same thing?
Same MO.
And how much the losses?
For this, we cannot estimate at the present moment. As I mentioned, the losses are in China. We are working with the Chinese counterparts to come back to us exactly what the losses are. As I mentioned, you need arrested 2 days ago.
Millions a month, so you suspect it being the millions.
Because the overhead is very high. They are paying a couple of thousand rupees per person, multiplied by 100, get the rental, get the flight tickets, so they must be making much, much more than every month.
Dr. Sri, no quantum of cash seized bank accounts in Malaysia?
So far, not as yet. We, as I mentioned, we just arrested 2 days ago, so we're still working on it. Lain soalan mengenai kes ni?
Datuk Sri, macam mana dengan nasib 99 orang untuk adakah kita riman? Datuk Sri, bila sampai bila?
Mereka diriman di bawah Seksyen 117 dan apabila tamat, kami akan meneruskan dengan Akta Immigration.
Dan Datuk Sri kata tadi ada masalah untuk pertukaran di mahkamah kan? Jadi boleh explain pasal itu tak? Macam mana akan?
Seperti mana saya sebut, mangsa dalam kes ni adalah di negara China. Dan kadang-kadang ada agak susah bagi kita mendapat keterangan dan seterusnya lah. It takes a very long time to proceed. Because all the victims here are in China.
So are you working with Chinese
authorities? We are working with the Chinese authorities. Incidentally, the minute the raid was done, we called our Chinese counterpart to assist us in the case.
Can we ask on any other topics?
We focus on this first. Any other soalan on this topic? Tapi nampak tuan-tuan ada topik-topik lain yang lebih menarik. Ada lain soalan kes ni?
Tapi yang umur 14 tu dia memang datang dulu untuk kerja.
Yang umur 14 ni ialah seorang warga negara Malaysia yang kerja bersama-sama mereka.
Dia buat panggilan juga ke tapi?
Tak dengar?
Dia buat panggilan juga.
Ada, dia sama-sama terlibat. Semasa pemeriksaan kita ke premis tersebut, semua mereka duduk di atas meja panjang sedang berinteraksi dengan pelanggan-pelanggan atau mangsa-mangsa di negara China.
Parent sendiri ada sekali ke macam tu?
Tak ada.
Only one teenager.
Only one 14-year-old boy. The rest in the 20s till 44.
Berapa gaji diorang?
Gaji lebih dari 2,500 seorang. You can estimate How much they are only paying salaries? Mungkin ada ijazah menipu. Okay.
Six Malaysians and the rest are all Chinese.
Yes, correct. Six Malaysians, the rest are Chinese. All in, there were 99 individuals arrested. And of these 99, one was a Dato' Sri.
It's a Malaysian.
Correct.
Is he still a student?
No, he's not more a student. He's working full time here.
Boy.
Does it make a difference whether it's a boy or girl? Okay. Ada lain soalan tuan-tuan dan puan?
Datuk Seri yang ditangkap tu dia ada political connection ke atau dia memang ada kenyataan?
Yang di mana?
Yang Datuk Seri yang ditangkap.
Kita sedang menyiasat tu lah. Sedang menyiasat tu. Ada lain soalan tuan-tuan dan puan? Lepas ni kita ambil gambar lah for all this. Ha? Okay, lain? Ada? Tak ada? Okay, you open the floor now to any other question that you wish to ask.
Dato' Sri, there's this blogger, right, RPK, who accused the police of, well, in his words, stealing 43.3 million after you raided the pavilion residences linked to our former Prime Minister. Mm. He's saying the seized amount is actually 160 million, but you declared 116 around there. In his blog post, he's saying the 43.3 million is what UMNO is seeking back now. So, he's basically accusing you of stealing the money. What is your response?
Thank you for asking the question. Terima kasih kerana tanyakan soalan tersebut. Okay, first and foremost, I will not pay heed to such a writer. RPK claims to be an investigative journalist, but looks like he's very far from being an investigative journalist. He's more like a missionary. So what he's doing is, he's actually coming up with very frivolous and vexatious accusations against the police, and I will not stand quiet receiving such accusations, because they are such baseless accusations altogether. Allow me to proceed further in the sense that if he has got such information with him, if RPK has got some credible information with him stating that indeed 43.8 million was stolen at a pavilion, please lodge a report in Malaysia. Don't hide behind the cyber curtain. So I'm urging him, be brave enough to lodge a police report in Malaysia, but don't hide behind a cyber curtain, because with lodging a police report, well, if it's found to be false, he will get the full wrath of lodging a false report. Allow me to clarify where his basis was. That's why I'm rather disappointed with his investigative journalism. He is using the basis that on the 25th of May, I had stated during my PC that there was 114 million seized. Subsequently, he says that on the 28th of June, I say altogether there were 116 million seized. He's using this discrepancy to state that we are not sure with the figures. Allow me to clarify this. For the PC on the 25th of May 2018, which was just a few days after the actual raid, the raid was conducted on the 17th of May, after we had counted the money, this was, as I mentioned in the PC, this 114 million was in 26 currencies, and it is the money found at Pavilion residence. The 114 million was found at Pavilion residence. Furtherance to that, we conducted, for information, we had also conducted on the 16th, 17th, six premises all in. One such premise was this permanent residence. We also conducted search at the office at Sri Pradana and three other premises in Pavilion. So the 114 million was only at one premise at Pavilion, which is at B45. If you look carefully at my PC, I had mentioned that in that one raid, one premise, we recovered 114 million. Subsequent to that, on the 28th of June, after we had finished counting all our exhibits, i.e. we had finished counting the money, we had finished counting the jewelry, the bags, the watches, everything, And in all the premises, only then I gave my PC on the total amount recovered in the premises linked to Dato Sri Najib. And on that PC which I gave on the 28th of June, I had mentioned the total amount is 116 million. So from here we can know 114 million in 26 currencies was found in the pavilion residence. The remainder came from his premise at Jalan Duta. Does that make it clear? Number one. Number two. Upon our press conference on the 25th of May 2018, only after this does a claimant come and says that the money belongs to him. There was no claim prior to this. There were so many days, even during the search, they were aware that we were making searches of these premises, but nobody came to claim that it belonged to them. Only after we came with the amount, 1 week after that, somebody comes about and says, this money belongs to us, and the actual amount is 160 million. The police have conducted investigations on his report, but this individual only says 160 million, but cannot come with a substantiate the basis for this amount. He cannot say how he came with the 160 million. For information, I first and foremost would like to confirm 101% that on that day of the raid, as I mentioned to you all during the PC during the raid, I'm very, very sure that we only found, what was found is what is recovered. The total amount recovered was at the premises was 114 million, which was in 26 currencies. So I will not take it lightly in the sense that somebody accuses the police of stealing the money when the person cannot substantiate the money. Now allow me to say whether is it possible, the investigating reporter should have done, whether is it possible to steal such money. If you notice, there were 72 bags recovered in the premises, correct? From the 72 bags, 35 contained cash. That means 35 big bags, and you saw the bags, they were very big bags, contained 114 million. So to accommodate 43 million, you need about 10 to 15 bags. Is that correct? Now you tell me, how will we be able to move these bags from such a premise with about 100 CCTVs there? With 50 policemen, with video recording, with cameras, and another 50 reporters waiting outside for me. And the only entry in and out of the building is through the lift and the lobby, which we used to come out. So there's no way anything can be taken from the premises. Probably, if they still feel it's 160 million, it would have been stolen by the people whom they employed to transfer the money to such premises. We know as evidence, money moved into the premises 2 days after elections, i.e. on the 10th, on the 11th of May. Money was brought in on the 11th of May by about 30 individuals employed by them to move from premises which they are aware of to pavilion. Does that answer your question? So please don't blame the police, and we are not happy with such accusations because it tarnishes the image of very good and very hard-working policemen. Any questions?
What is the likeliness of RPK being arrested if he comes in? What's his statement to you?
He will not be arrested. He has got every right to lodge a police report, but be brave enough to lodge a report in Malaysia, because at least he'll be able to ask him to substantiate his basis. But if it's found to be false, then he should get the full wrath of the law. Lodge in Malaysia. Don't hide behind a cyber curtain.
Yes. Reported that UMNO has actually taken legal action,
I'm aware of that, yeah. So UMNO is filing a suit now against us police officers using the report lodged by Dato Sri Najib. In actual fact, The one who should be filing the writ should be from Dato Sri Narayan himself. But he cannot substantiate the amount. The statement is recorded, he couldn't substantiate where the money came from. At least if you say it's 160, how did we arrive at such a number?
So, Dr. Srinajib was the one who came to claim the money but could not.
He lodged a report stating that there was 160 million and only this was only lodged after we made our statement, our press release, stating that 114 was won. Prior to this, they did not even come forward to say how much money there was. Yes, it did. Adeline Solan, Tuan Rumban. So I hope this puts to rest. You will notice that it will be practically impossible to move things out on the building. And I can assure you, what was in the house is what was recovered by us. And what was recovered by us is what was informed to you on the 28th of June during the PC. And all these exhibits are kept at Bank Negara at the present moment. Ada lain soalan tuan-tuan perempuan? Yes, sir.
Saya kata sila buat laporan di Malaysia. Okey, itu daripada pihak orang yang mendakwa tadi lah. Tapi daripada pihak polis ni, adakah tindakan akan diambil ke atas mereka yang mengeluarkan dakwaan-dakwaan tu?
Jika laporan itu palsu, kita akan mengambil tindakan. Bukan, sesiapa boleh membuat allegation like this. But the sad part is, it tarnishes the image of the police. Alright, it tarnishes the image of myself, the director, and my officers who were with me at the time. Because you notice there were 50 people and we met for the first time there. Some from the traffic, from the CID, some from UTK, and we will not even know them. And you tell me it will be very difficult, it's impossible to move things out. Because I was there and we can assure you nothing came out of the building except what was recovered.
Has anyone from UMNO explained why they had money in 26 different currencies?
You should ask them why 26 different currencies. Even I am a bit surprised. I'm happy that they picked it up. And some of the currencies, some of the notes were in $1,000 notes in foreign currencies. Why do you have such notes? Unless they're investing in something. Forex, yeah.
So just to clarify one more time. So after you declared the amount seized from the rank, Dato Sri Najib lodged the police report.
Yes. After I reported on the 25th of May, stating the exact amount at Pavilion Residence. Please don't get me wrong, at Pavilion Residence, only about a week after that, they come forward to say that in actual amount was 160 million.
Then he launched a report saying there was 160
million.
And then what happened?
Independent investigator had investigated the case, but when we asked him to substantiate, they could not substantiate the amount. You see, when you say you have got 160 million, you must come with some document, something to say that this is my account to show that this money was taken out. And as rightly pointed out by a good self, why in foreign currency? And as I mentioned, 26 different foreign currencies. And the counting was done by Bank Negara officers, not by me. Line soalan tu number one? Tak ada? Terima kasih. Thank you. Yes. Oh. Looks like terima kasih is
terima kasih memberi peluang. Yes.
Okay.
The IG said that Dr. Sri Rosmah will call in to identify the seizures.
Yes, she will. Yes, she will.
Yes, I believe it's your department who's going to handle that. When should we call
in? Soon. I think date is not important. Soon to give us her clarification as to the item seized. Yeah.
Next month?
Soon. Yeah.
Ahmad,
yes, may, madam. Yeah.
If I may, it's just been announced that there will be a Hollywood movie made about 1MDB through
the. What movie?
Hollywood.
Hollywood, movie. Okay.
Hollywood is producing a $1 billion whale. How do you feel about there being a movie being made about this whole investigation and scandal?
Okay. I've got no comments.
Have you read the book?
I'm about to read the book, yeah. Probably they need to call me to act in the part for the raid in Pavilion. I know you wanted me to say that, probably they need to call me to... Yeah, thank you. No, I'm just trying to add a bit of jest in the meeting here. Okay, anything else? Ada sebarang soalan? Tak ada? Yes, sir. Tak dengar? Saya boleh mengesahkan beliau dipanggil dua kali untuk memberi keterangan beliau bersabit dengan kes 1MDB.
Would you be calling any other
We will still be calling. We have so far recorded about 70 odd statements. In this case, we will still be recording several other statements. And we shall be calling Dato' Sri Najib soon with regards to this case, 1 MDP. Okay, thank you very, very much. Let's have some photograph session. Come. Terima kasih, tuan-tuan dan puan-puan.